My name is Jared Rydelik. For nearly a decade, I have traveled the world in order to document rare fruit. There are tens of thousands of fruit species in the world, and I'm on a mission to find them all. Over the years, I have visited the jungles of Borneo, the rainforests of the Amazon, the sprawling markets of India and Madagascar, all in order to try and find and taste fruit that I haven't had. So why am I in Iceland now? Have I lost my mind? Iceland is not exactly the first place that comes to mind when you think of plant diversity. A recent study showed that only 1.2% of Iceland's landmass is conducive for growing crops. Let me repeat that. Only 1.2%. If you do the math, that is less than 500 square miles of arable land in the entire country. It wasn't always this way. Long ago, when Iceland was uninhabited, it had vast forests. However, when Vikings first settled in Iceland in the 9th century, they cut down nearly all the trees for lumber. Vikings also introduced sheep, which, although are adorable, their constant grazing and their taste for young saplings has also contributed to soil erosion. You can't get too mad at them, though. Look at that face. Iceland is also affected by climate change, harsh winters, and a dark season where for several months out of the year, there is little to no sunlight. Regrowing trees in the country has been an ongoing struggle that will hopefully be solved in the near future. But for now, the majority of fruits and vegetables that you find in Iceland are imported. In the past, I've traveled to other Scandinavian countries in order to document berries. And Iceland surely has some berries, right? Well, there's good news. There are several berries that grow in Iceland, and some of them I haven't had before. Foraging is a popular pastime in Iceland, and if you visit during the berry picking season, you can find entire fields just completely covered in berries.
These are all crowberries, and it's like everywhere. Like, all throughout here, you see crowberries all over the place.
These, I think, are bog bilberries.
They're also, like, all over the place, but as you see, all those little flowers there, yeah, it's not the right season.
Yeah, I didn't go during berry season. Maybe I did lose my mind. As odd as it may seem for a fruit hunter to visit a place that seems to be fruitless, you should keep in mind that Iceland is a country full of contradictions. Iceland is one of the least populated countries in Europe, yet it's one of the happiest countries on Earth. Much of its population lives a simple life centered around horse breeding and fishing, and yet it's one of the world's wealthiest countries. And although only 1.2% of its land is conducive for growing plants, Iceland has the reputation for being the number one producer of bananas in all of Europe. This is an ironic piece of information that sometimes shows up on strange fact lists and on quiz shows.
The largest banana producing country in Europe is Iceland.
When I heard about this, I didn't believe it, so I decided to find out for myself. So come and join me on my adventure to find the Icelandic banana, an adventure that starts by taking a look into the incredibly unique geography of this country.
That there is an erupting volcano. Iceland is right on top of the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which are two tectonic plates coming together. Okay, so there's tectonic plates, if you remember from grade school, like they go towards each other and they form mountains and they separate, and then magma can come up from the bottom of the earth. So magma going up underwater can form islands, and that's actually how Iceland was formed 60 million years ago. But that activity is still there, and those two plates are going apart, and when that happens, this sort of stuff happens. There's a lot of geologic activity under the surface of this country, so magma comes up fairly often, as you see right there. And also, you get geysers, you get earthquakes, you get a lot. And the people of Iceland have found a way to harness that energy. It's incredible. Tell you is this smells and it has a sound. Like, it looks cool, yeah, but the smell in the air is like a little bit, it's a little bit sulfuric but also burning, so it smells like a burning egg. Like you cook the egg too long on the stove, and if you get close to it you hear it cracking. Sounds like a roaring fire. Oh yeah, that is a scent.
It's getting a bit strong, actually. I should probably get away from this thing. This is what it looks like when it starts raining on a lava field. Oh my god. I'm gonna stay up here. All these tourists down there are just like inside a cloud of noxious gas from the earth. Is that a good idea, guys? Come on. I'm gonna stay up here for a couple of minutes. But oh my god, that's incredible looking.
I found some crowberries here that have ripened.
Maybe because of this business that's going on over here. So this lava field has come through and I think maybe jump-started the growth of these berries, but then it got too hot and it cooked them. That's really neat. You can even see up here, you can see all this kind of like scorched land here.
Wait a minute. Oh. There we go. They look like they might be bear berries, actually. Yeah, those taste like bear berries. They're like slightly sweet, mild, not a whole lot there. Maybe like a faint, like, strawberry flavor. It's just weird to see them growing here because they're not supposed to be in season. It's way too early. Everyone told me there's no chance I'll find any berries here at all. But I think because of this lava that's going on, they ripen faster. They're getting more warmth here. I'm not sure, but it's pretty cool. So I think I've had that before. It's not the best berry in the world, but in this kind of setting, pretty neat.
Okay, so what does this have to do with bananas? Well, if I'm right, and it is the heat from the volcano that is causing these berries to ripen faster, Well, then maybe the heat from the Earth could also be used to ripen something a little bit more tropical. To grow an Icelandic banana, you don't just plant a banana seed in a lava field. This is complicated stuff, and clearly, I don't really know what I'm talking about. So in order to learn more, I paid a visit to the Agricultural University of Iceland. This is the site of the country's largest banana collection.
So we are standing in front of what we call the banana house, from what I know, the only greenhouse in Iceland producing bananas. They are not being produced to be sold, but they were in the beginning thought of to be a good trial to see if Icelanders could create their own bananas, so they wouldn't have to import them. Sadly, it didn't continue, but at least they're here. And also, since there are problems somewhere in other parts of the world, we're also being able to maintain some varieties in here, since we're on an island, not having the same problem with diseases and pests. To be able to maintain the temperature, we are completely dependent on geothermal energy.
Even warmer.
Yeah.
The whole room has a wonderful scent to it.
Yeah.
Like floral, tropical smell.
Yeah, it's a bit surrealistic to come in here during the winter time when you're having maybe a couple of meters of snow, and you're coming in here and you're suddenly in a different country or world. We have a fig tree here, and we just usually bring us figs in the fall. Yeah, they are being sought after because they're quite expensive when they're being imported. Yeah, we need to keep an eye on them if you want to get them, because if people come in here,
yeah,
they see the pigs, they'll be
those eating.
Yeah.
They don't last very long. Uh-huh.
I was very generously given a tour of this facility, and I saw an impressive collection of plants. Monstera, figs, cacao, citrus fruits. There seemed to be no limit to the plants that could be successfully grown in Iceland. And then I was shown what I originally came here for.
You can see the Latin name here, and you can see the Icelandic name here as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's a Cavendish, so it's a finger banana with small ones. And they're really sought after because we let them finish, get ripe. It's a bit different from the ones we buy in the store. So we have the opportunity to prove the difference between a fruit that is picked ripe and fruit that is picked unripe for importing or exporting.
Mm.
So it's a completely different experience for all the senses, I guess.
There's no pesticides, and you also said that there is no artificial light here also.
There we have one light here, but as you can see, it's just off. It was mostly put up there as work light, so...
I see. Since there's a dark period in Iceland, does that have a strong effect on the plants here?
Yeah, it's absolutely having an effect. So it's minimizing the possibility of the plant photosynthesizing at that period, because the clusters here, which are being produced by the plants, are taking up to 2 years. In Asia, it's taking maybe 1.5 years. So it's taking much longer, which tells us obviously that it doesn't have the same energy.
Have any of the plants that you've grown here just couldn't have it? That the darkness has killed them off entirely?
It can confuse them, you can say.
Mm-hmm.
So it can have quite a large effect, of course.
Confuse a plant, but not entirely stop it.
No.
So that's interesting.
I think the plant will use every opportunity and chance to try and survive in the end. So it will wait. It can have a waiting period. But you can see when the light is being increased, naturally, they grow on double speed, triple speed.
Oh, really? Yeah, so they make up for the lost time.
Well, they go for it. These guys here, I'm not sure if they'll continue to ripe, but maybe we can just... give these to you.
Oh, thank you so much.
Okay, great. So I found the banana that was grown by geothermal energy, and I guess I could end the video here. But that would be doing a disservice to the banana and to the country. Seeing this collection of tropical plants felt like I was watching a magic trick. I was impressed, but now I wanted to see what the secret was behind it. So let's follow this rabbit hole even further.
I had to get my cat into the episode somehow. Well, everybody, I hope you enjoyed part one in what is going to be a 6-part series about my adventure to find the Icelandic banana. So I found it, but I am not done exploring it. There's a lot more to talk about. And part two is going to be about how the earth can be used not just to grow food, but also it can be used to cook food. And that will be, well, if it's up now, there'll be a link on the screen somewhere. Click that. If you don't see the link, that means it's not out yet, or I forgot to put it there. This series was made possible by the support that I get over on Patreon. So Patreon supporters, thank you so much. If you are not on Patreon, now is a great time to consider it, because I'm going to be putting out a ton of exclusive content about this series in Iceland. If you go there now, there is a commentary for this episode that you just watched, as well as the future ones coming out, and a lot of behind-the-scenes footage. So check out the link in the description below if you'd like to learn more about that. I also want to give a big thank you to the Agricultural University of Iceland. It's really made this series something special. And there's going to be a lot more from them coming up in the future episodes. If you'd like to learn more about them, there's going to be a link in the description below, as well as other sources that I use to make this episode. I think this is a really interesting topic. If you're as interested as I am and you'd like to learn more, check out those links in the description below. Thanks so much, everybody. I will see you in the next one.